I have to start by many apologies. So first of all, I probably picked a very wrong slide for this, especially after hearing Nick and Jane. What I talk about abstraction is not what they say about abstraction. Unfortunately, less useful. So, and it will be clear in the talk, but it's not actually what they mean about abstraction. I love to understand what they mean about abstraction. And the second apology is that actually this is a joint work. It's actually, I've done nothing here. So Kalev Alpanas, who is a PhD student at Tel Aviv University, Sharon Shoham, who is a colleague in Tel Aviv University, and Roman Manevich, who is a colleague at University, and Panda, who is sitting somewhere in the middle here, and he will be faculty member at NYU starting next year. So these are the people who really did this work, and I'm just here to try to confuse you about it. So basically, we look into the problem of verification, which is important, and you have some network, and you are trying to prove some properties of the network. Oh, now I cannot see, or I can see my slide. So, for example, we want to prove that some packet will not be reached. For example, packet from Simon will not reach Bob. So usually, in a stateless network, this usually means like finding reachability and reasoning about reachability. But once the state is in the middle, then things can get really complicated. Like, for example, you are putting cache proxy for performance. You're putting other things. So basically, now what happened is that Bob sent a message. Oops, sorry. My PDF is not working well, but somehow the idea is that, sorry, I don't have, can you hear me? So what happened is that when Bob sent a message, now it is recorded, and then later on, when this message will be responded, then in fact, you will get some traffic that you don't like. And all of it is coming from the fact that you are having state. Okay, so state actually, the need of the state, make the network verification much, much harder. So, and can you hear me now, or should I go? Yes. So, is this problem hard? So basically, according to a study by the network community, about 50% of the bug actually occurs for middle boxes and for state, which occurs in network. But this is a big problem for network verification. And in fact, if you think about it, in realistic situation, it's a very complex situation, because you look into the stateful network, that's actually written by very, very complex code. I took here the example of the Bohr network. It has a lot of code, it's very complex, it's not even clear what this code is about to do. And one of the most interesting things for us is the interaction between the middle box behavior. So somehow it's not really a bug in having one middle box, it's the connection of them together. So here is a very, very simple example. Again, I apologize. I actually use the PDF and now I see I don't have another animation anymore. But the idea is that I have this bin here who is sending a package through the net. And what happened, the net is actually transferring from a local to a global address, and now it's able to pass through the ACL. So that's somehow, so basically what happens, because of the interaction between the middle boxes, you get errors. And this is essentially the kind of bug that we want to get. So we are coming from a slightly different community, and I want actually, there is some things that we learn in this verification community. And one lesson which is probably really surprising to some of you is actually in automatic verification, even in manual verification, when we are verifying a property, we are actually sometimes it's easier for us to put properties which are stronger. What I mean easier is that it may be something that is very, very hard, for example, undecidable. And then I put something stronger, which actually I think could be a much easier time. And that actually is surprising to some people. That means that when we do verification, we really have to carefully think about what we have to verify. Okay, so this is an idea, and it's been explored in many ways in the programming language community. What I'm using in this talk is just one incarnation, which actually Patrick Rousseau has been pushing for many years, is this idea of abstraction. But again, I'm using abstraction, sorry for the word. But what I mean by abstraction is that I'm ending up representing more behavior. So I take some behavior and I add something to it. I take, for example, a set of complete states, and then I abstract it and I represent more states. And I reason about more states, and actually it's much easier for me to put things about more states. Okay, so this is called abstraction. And then this process is called concretization. And this actually allows you to represent more states. And by representing more states, you make the verification problem easier. Okay? So here is a very, very simple example that you would see from Poisson's talk and many others. Basically, I'm looking into the set of the integers. And I'm only representing all the even. So basically, this says that actually this is an empty set. This says it's the even number. This is the odd number. This says I really don't know. And you see, this is the abstraction, that I take the empty set and I take the fact that it's the empty set. But the more interesting is what's going on here. If you give me a set which has only zero, I forget about it. I say I have the even number. If you give me a set which has two, I forget about it and have the even number. And all of it is represented by all the even numbers. And now, if you give me a set which includes both even and odd, I'm going to lose this information. Because the abstraction actually cannot distinguish between these types. So then I'm actually ending up representing everything. And the art of abstraction is actually find the right abstraction that allows you to prove properly. Okay, so this is what people have done for Astrid, for many things. They have found abstractions that are useful to prove properties of control plane. They found some properties which are interesting in order to prove what you want. And again, just to take this simple example, again, it's a tiny example. I'm sure you have seen it in many cases. I have a function here, and it's a function of two variables, and it computes the value. I'm showing the tree of the value. So here in the table, you see the normal complete interpretation, how you do addition and how you do multiplication. Instead of it, we're going to work in the abstract representation. So this is basically just we have this partition. And we know that if we multiply a number odd by odd, we get a number which is odd. Okay? If we multiply a number that we don't know, we don't know. But if we multiply a number that we don't know, if it's odd and even, we multiply it by even, we get the even. So this is kind of simple conservative reasoning. But you'll be surprised how far we can go. So here in this example, you see again, you don't see my animation, but you see that eventually we look into the tree, we operate in a bottom-line fashion, and eventually we reach the situation that it's an odd value. So we actually prove that this function here, we don't know which number it is, but it returns an odd value. Okay, so this is kind of the thing that we do with this abstract interpretation. Okay, another thing that is somehow useful, and actually will be useful, is the idea of Cartesian abstraction. So what is a Cartesian abstraction? It's a very, very simple abstraction. We look into sets, or for example, pairs, and we lose the correlation between certain points. So here, for example, you see we have A1, P2, and C2, and we forget the correlation between A and B. So we end up representing that there is either A, B, or C, or either 1 and 2. So I represented this set, but we're also representing more elements. Okay? So we are also representing more elements. Because, for example, you see that the value A2 was not in the original set, and now it is represented. So we're actually representing more elements. So, and actually, again, the animation is bad here. When we look into programs, actually it's even because you look into the trace. PDF is not so good for me. But the idea is I look into this place, and now all of these guys will be represented by one element. So I will end up representing a trace which actually doesn't occur in the program, because, for example, this trace here is not going to be, it's a trace that is actually in does not occur in the program, and still I will end up representing. And when I prove that the program has some property, I know that this program will hold in all traces. But in fact, I represented more traces which are possible. Okay, so there's another lesson I have to tell you about abstraction. Maybe it's less surprising, but it's also important, that sometimes by looking into different programs, you can actually prove things in a much easier way. So you give me one program, the analysis failed, but now after I do this thing, I will do this rewrite, I will get something which is actually easier. I'll get something that is actually easier to tell. And I'll show you how this works. So how can this, you're probably thinking that I'm completely crazy, how can I apply these kind of things to that? So apparently, there are certain things that you can do in that part, and I will try to argue that they are mildly useful, that they actually show you that you can do things, that you can make network notification more possible. So what do we do in this way? So we have different kind of abstraction. So the first abstraction, that is maybe simple, but I think it's useful, we abstract the middle box as fine state machine. So this means, of course, the middle box is a very, very complex program, but we abstract the middle box as a fine state machine. Why is this useful? Because this actually already allows us to, for example, we don't need to reason about the broker. We only need to reason about the mode. Okay? Of course, it means that when we prove that the network is correct, it doesn't mean that the fault is correct. It just means that what we think about this model is correct. Okay, so this is one abstraction that we do. The second abstraction that we do is that we abstract the order of packet processing. Okay? So this is interesting because, in fact, it allows us to prove some desirability. Because without that, in fact, we can do things which are more complex. So that's actually one thing which is interesting. If we do this over approximation and we reason about sets and not sequences, we get something which is more possible to automate. This by itself doesn't scale well. So if you have a large network, like you have many, many hosts, then in fact we're going to have to do something more complex. So what we do there, we have different abstractions, which are like kind of a partition abstraction, and it's a little tricky. I try to explain them with the number of slides I have. But what they get you eventually, the bottom line is that they get you, and actually we do have implementation, you get to something which has polynomial complexity in terms of the number of hosts and in terms of the number of middle hosts. So we have a mechanism that if you are building this thing, we can actually prove the next. Yes, ask a question at any time.
If you do this last step, I mean, if your representation is of a middle box as a finite state machine, so you just make it a not deterministic finite state machine.
Right.
And you can transfer it to a deterministic state machine again by the cost of first, perhaps you have exponential growth in states. Is that correct?
Yeah. You could, but it's not going to help you because remember, we are not really so much worried about the individual state machines. Mm-hmm. We are worried about how they interact together. Mm-hmm. Even there's not this issue of you can convert from deterministic to deterministic, but we are worried about the fact that there is one state machine, it sends a message, and then the other message is sent to it. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, the connection between a proxy and a cache firewall. I'm worried about the connection between. So I'm not actually worried about this individual state machine. I'm really worried about the connection between them. And in fact, it's not regular or anything. I can have many, many behaviors. Okay?
Okay.
So, yes?
So you avoid analyzing the code. And so how do you guarantee that, is there any guarantee that this final state machine will be actually the code that runs?
You can think about it as a bug or a feature. We are not checking that at the moment. It's an interesting question to check it. But on the other hand, if you think about it, at least in our understanding, there are only very few types of middle boxes. So it's actually nice because you can analyze this model, but you are absolutely right. We are not checking that the real map, and actually there is a very nice paper system by the EPFL book where they actually reason about net, about the real map. But that's not what we are doing here.
Yes. So there's a question about this.
I have a question. I'm still going to go on my slide.
About the second, the third abstraction. So I understand that by doing those abstractions, you can make your verification efficient. But did you also introduce the false positive?
That's a wonderful question. Great question. So that's the problem of our work, that we can introduce false positive. But in this work, actually, I give you some network condition under which it would not happen. So at least as a network guy, you will see. But usually when you ask about program, that's the problem. Well, I work in static analysis, and people don't like me. Because, yeah. And I can tell you all kinds of funny stories. Yeah, yeah. So that's definitely a beautiful question. We get it. That's the problem of our work. So, Okay, thank you. So let's start with this first abstraction. So our hypothesis is for safety. I understand that you guys coming from network and you say these middle books are very complex. You have one, but what Plant is telling me is that maybe for our purpose we can actually look at them in the finite state machine, because we're not actually interested to prove performance or whatever. We're only interested to prove something like isolation. But for example, from some network you don't get another network. So for that purpose, we are drawing, so for example, this is a stateful firewall, right? So here is a stateful firewall. It's very, very complex. There are many, many updates to get. But for our purpose, if you look at it, basically, there are these packets, and there are this distinction. And in fact, this one is actually constant or immutable. The only thing that the packet update is this, whether the connection is established or the connection is not established. So now we can actually construct like a finite state machine for the purpose of checking isolation, because we are only interested to know if a packet was sent or not sent. Okay? So for our purpose, we can construct this finite state machine, and I should say we only know how to do it by hand. It's not that we have any mechanism to construct. We look into the things that people have done, like these are things that we have looked at. Net, load balancer, cache, web accelerator, and for all of them, we know how to construct this model in finite state machines. Okay, and we think it's possible, we don't have a proof, but we think it's possible for the purpose of isolation. So basically, we can construct this finite state machine and then reason about isolation. And just to sort of show you, just to show you this finite state machine, here I know it's a little bit. So basically, you see, this is a finite state machine for simple firewall. So the state remembers who are the trusted hosts. And basically, what happens, you see that when you go from a state to state, more hosts become trusted, so the forwarding rules change. And the forwarding rules change over time. So that's basically a finite state machine for a trusted firewall. Okay, for a stateless firewall, a whole function firewall. And you see, these are the finite state machine, and these are what our system can analyze. You give this finite state machine, and you give the topology that shows how they're connected, and then we prove the property that. Okay? And you notice that there is something tricky here, that if you look into this finite state machine, they can actually grow very big. Non-deterministic or deterministic, they can grow very big. For example, if you have three hosts, then you have all these subset of three and so on. So in fact, this finite state machine itself can go very big. But fortunately, that is something that programming language guys, we have solution for that. So we can actually import this finite state machine in compact way. And this actually amounts to a similar work which actually came from SICO, I'm sure some of you are in the audience, but the idea is that actually we can encode this compactly, and if it's in common cases, we have exponential safety. So that's basically how our finite state machine looks like. It's a reactive program. It looks into the triples, and basically, based on that, it does the forwarding rule. And this is just a compact representation of this finite state machine. And if you look into our system, that's what we analyze. We analyze finite state machine, which are expressed in this language. We call it the middle book description language. So this is sort of, and it's a reactive program. You see that there are relations, which says the trusted, and basically you update the trusted relation. Okay, so I have 5 minutes. So one of the things which is tricky is
in generating this compact representation is a manual process.
It's a manual, basically people write that. We have this thing that we,
and is there hope for automatically generating?
From the finite state machine?
Or from code, finite state machines? Or?
I do not know. Okay. But the thing which is interesting about middle box, as I say, is the interaction between states. So for example, you see, B arrives here, then what happens now, this goes to A and it goes to another state. And when A will arrive here, then this will go to another state. And once you have the history, this becomes very tricky. So that's what we want to analyze, and this is the real problem that happens in that. This is what we want to analyze. So in fact, this is difficult, because what happens, you can actually, even with finite state machine, you can emulate the Turing machine. Because you can have the order of this message, and you can emulate the Turing machine. It's not so hard to see, but you can look into how. So what do we do? This is why we do abstraction. So the first abstraction, which is kind of natural, we ignore the order of packets. So basically, probably the animation will not come right. But the idea is, instead of processing the packet in order, I process it in an arbitrary order. Okay, and of course, if I prove the property, hold it, hold. But maybe if you have something which is related to the order, it's not going to hold. But I think that actually, at least from our experience, this does not lead to loss of precision. So you see, you just basically update them, process them out of order, and this gives us a solution. So the interesting thing, oh, it does, see, I'm processing it. So this actually gives us algorithmic decidability. And how do we prove that it's decidable? We actually reduce it to the net to the Petri net. Those of you who know, I actually used a picture of Petri. Unfortunately, as you probably know, Petri net invented it when he was in 13. I don't have a picture of him when he was 13. But this is the idea that you can reduce to Petri net. That's great for theoretical results, but it's not practical, because you get exponential complexity. So that's where we do something more interesting, and I guess I don't have a lot of time to tell you, but basically we do some kind of Cartesian abstraction, and just to show it on a simple network, you see that you can actually ignore the correlation. So for example, this is a very simple network, and I get this forwarding here, where I forward fix, which came from port 2 into fix, which from source 2 into fix, which called to source 1. And then you see that, in fact, I remember all the configuration that happens. You see that here I remember the relation A, and I remember the relation B. So basically, the possible values of A and B are empty set and empty set, 1 and 1, 2 and 1 and 2 and 1 and 2. And when I do the abstract interpretation, what happened is that, in fact, I lost the correlation. That's exactly what you say. I'm going to get a false error. So that's not good. So in fact, what we have a better way. We have some way that we actually avoid false error by actually representing the mapping between the packet and the forwarding behavior. Okay, I don't have a lot of time to show you, but that's basically what we do. Represent it, if you look into the paper, we actually have a way to represent the mapping from the packet to the forwarding behavior. And the question is, when is it precise? That's the question that you ask. So that's actually pretty interesting. We, in general, for real programs, we don't know how to do anything. But apparently, for network, actually, there is a sweet spot. So what happens is that you think about middle boxes, and think of what I think people call a network that's called soft state. So think of a situation that every time the finite state machine can go to the initial state, non-deterministic. Okay, maybe that's not realistic, but maybe in this situation, so basically, for example, you see here, I'm connected from the, basically the firewall can always lose the trusted host. It can always go to the beginning. And in this case, in fact, we can show that, again, automatic verification becomes easier. For when you have soft state, automatic verification becomes easier, and this algorithm that I hinted on is actually going to be precise. So we are able to show you that, in fact, there won't be any false alarm if you are checking the isolation, and if you are assuming that each of these middle pops can revert to its initial state. So these are two requirements. You all look very suspicious.
No, not suspicious, puzzled. So, okay. So going back to the firewall example, so if you mark some host as trusted,
doesn't do anything.
Okay. If you mark some host as trusted, then you lost that information.
Right. So
doesn't that mean that you will be making the wrong decision?
So I'm going to make the right decision, but it's going to be hard for me to prove that I made the right decision. In a sense that what happened is that if I only want to prove to you that I have isolation, I'm good. But if you want me to prove that I obey the firewall policy, I'm in trouble. Because this is actually a property which depends on the history. Mm-hmm. Yes, I am. This is limited. You can think about this is a cheap thing that you can do in the network, and it will prove isolation. But if you want me to prove something beyond isolation, I need to think 10 more years and get part of that many holes most.
Yeah, you're just proving safety property.
Exactly, but it's a very simple safety. It's a safety property which does not depend on the history.
It's not even safety. So I'm not actually proving, like the safety that he was, like I don't sense to leave unless he sent to me, that I'm unable to see. I have three more minutes and I wanted to show you. So we have implementation and we have graphs. That's the what I think I understand. We have to have graphs. So, and it's scary. Okay, after my understanding was scaring me, it's scary. So basically, and it scares in terms of the number of the host, it also scares in terms of the number of the mirror boxes. I should say that in fact, it doesn't scale in terms of the mirror box code. So if the mirror box code would get complicated, the analysis is actually exponential in mirror box code. But we think that in fact for this thing, it's okay. I'm sorry, I went a little bit out of time. I want to just say, because there are a lot of beautiful work, the work by Marta in NSPI, we actually attacks exactly the same problem of finite state machine, but it doesn't make any abstraction, it just reduces it to SMT. This actually, and then you use V3 to find if there are bugs. The advantage of it, there are no obstruction. The disadvantage of this doesn't scale well, so Panda does slicing, it actually slices the network into smaller things. And then there's a very nice work by the UPFL book, which actually they do something else, which is interesting. They actually verify the net by basically finding its invariant. This will be presented this year. And then they from that, after they find the invariant, then they reason about it, this is called state. So, we understand that it's limited, and just to summarize, it's a stateful abstraction, there is a programming language, we have some Cartesian abstraction, then we have something else that is called better. Thank you very much.
I want to get back to the issue of the fact that the state space explodes as the number of hosts explode.
So, but for our analysis, since we represented compactly and all the boxes we have is on top of, so in fact for us it's not a problem. At least for firewall for all the things, it's not in practice it's not a problem. For at least for the real box we look at.
I see. So, but the thing that I wanted to ask you about was the fact that you could. If you had a network with 1,000 hosts, for the kinds of applications you're looking at, you could represent all 1,000 hosts as, say, two symbolic hosts.
Right.
But the firewall, for instance, does not actually do different things based upon the host IP address, and the code basically acts parametrically with respect to all of the properties of the host. So, I'm not sure that concerning myself with scalability in terms of the number of hosts in these kinds of applications is the right scalability dimension to concern yourself with, because you could just represent those collections of hosts.
I think Panda
wants to answer.
I see. The problem is that if you go and
so
the MTI paper does in fact do that. If you go ask network operators, so for example, if you ask the Microsoft folk, they will tell you that the actual number of these parametric hosts can be large, or they are indeterminate because they change over time because of things around observing traffic patterns or observing various. So for example, if you're a data center operator, you will commonly say something like, oh, this host seems to sometimes generate traffic that looks like attack traffic. I'm going to move it to some place where I do more analysis, or where I move it to a certain set of rules. So it's just a question of the scalability I can worry about is how many policy groups there actually are. So is it really two or is it hundreds? And the second is how dynamic are these policy groups? So do you have to worry about what's happening to some host that's moving between these?
Right. So then you need to worry about not just applications like the stable firewall, but more sophisticated applications.
And you stop worrying about what the annual system. It's just that the stateful firewall still has a few, the same set of hosts. So, for example, you might have
two, a source and a destination, right?
No, so what I meant is, if you look at a stateful firewall's policy, so let's say a stateful firewall has a gigabyte of policy, it might be that there are only five classes of hosts, and one class of hosts can talk to certain destinations and other classes. So how many of those policy classes are there? So we have to worry about that. And whether things actually do move behind between those policy classes, which I think it's a control plane operation.
Right, but you would, that's outside the
principle. Yeah.
That would,
yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so thank you. We've reached lunch, so thanks again.